Hey everyone, it's Simon here with another video market update this week. I hope you're doing well. Markets have certainly been more challenging over the last couple of weeks, as you can see from the violence evident on the far right-hand side of this longer-term chart of the S&P 500 index. So this is going back to April 2014, and you can see that the violence here looks very similar to the violence we experienced back in February. Now, you can see that this market peak in early February was after a very, very prolonged run-up. And so we had a pretty big sell-off and quite a lot of back-and-forth choppy action following that. Now, the run-up that we've had into the October highs is nowhere near as long, so I don't think the sell-off probably needs to be as big as what we saw in February. It'll probably work itself out a little bit quicker. But if we go to a shorter term chart of the S&P, and this is the SPY, the ETF of the S&P 500 index, you can see that we've had a pretty decent sell-off and a little bit of a rally here. I wouldn't be surprised if we do have a little bit more of a sell-off this week, maybe into next week, and trace out a W bottom, which is kind of what we saw back in February. Okay, we had the sell-off, a rally, another sell-off, and pretty much that previous low was pinpointed, and we got this kind of W bottom effect. Wouldn't be surprised if a similar thing happens now. Just in terms of levels, the S&P 500 has pulled back again to its 200-day moving average, which acted as a really strong line in the sand back during the previous correction that we had. And it's also pretty much tested this 61.8% Fibonacci retracement level from this low in April. Now, this level here is also coincident, by the way, with that high and these lows here. So, you know, previous resistance becomes new support, and you can see how this works out. So, these sorts of levels will probably hold. And to be honest with you, if this sort of level here doesn't hold, I may very quickly become less sanguine about the market. But for now, I'm going to respect the trend that is, and indeed respect the trend that was, and continue to give the uptrend the benefit of the doubt. Let's just have a quick chat about the background. The US economy seems to be humming along very nicely. The economic data continues to be pretty robust. There's no recession in sight. So if you want to get bearish on the market right here, right now, I think the key question you need to ask yourself is, will the Fed squash the economy into a recession within the next 6 to 9 months? Now, if you think the Fed, by raising rates, will engineer the next recession in the next 6 to 9 months, then now is probably a good time to get bearish on the markets. I don't think that's the case. I think the Fed remain data driven in terms of their policy, and I think that they are raising rates for the right reason, i.e. the economy continues to improve, continues to remain pretty strong. The other thing that you've probably noticed is that everybody is worried about everything, whether it's the trade war, whether it's rising bond yields, whether it's the Fed increasing rates, or the Fed withdrawing liquidity by reducing their balance sheet, whether it's the fact that the tax cuts are only providing a sugar high. I mean, there's a whole laundry list of worries at the moment. And frankly, investor sentiment is at levels that you'd normally see near the bottom of a bear market low, you know, not near the high of a bull market. And, you know, let's face it, the market is only 4 or 5% off its all-time highs. Things are not that bad, folks. And in terms of the global economy, the IMF are still forecasting 3.7% GDP growth for the world this year and next year, which is pretty okay. Earnings so far, look, it's early days, but according to FactSet, 17% of companies in the S&P 500 have reported so far. 80% of them have beat earnings expectations, which is above average, and 64% have beaten on top line on sales, which is also above average. So earnings, it's early days, but earnings still look pretty robust. So let's just go through now and have a bit of a look at some of the key charts. So again, this is the S&P 500 ETF. tested support, tested the 61.8% level. I mean, if we can hold the 200-day moving average here and clear back above this 38.2, I think the market goes higher. So need to keep an eye on that. Expect the next week or two could continue to be fairly choppy. Let's have a look at the triple Qs, the NASDAQ ETF. Similar sort of thing. We've definitely seen a fairly heavy deterioration here. Here we've probed both the 200-day moving average and the 50% retracement level, which tends to be a pretty key support level. The NASDAQ does look a little bit more bullish than the S&P, not surprisingly, given that tech has been one of the leading sectors and financials haven't, and there are no financials in the NASDAQ. Again, if we can reclaim this sort of level, I think the market will make new highs. Going sector by sector, basic materials, this is really broken down. It's making new lows. No need to be in this sector unless you're looking for short opportunities, but shorting now is probably not your best bet. You want to wait for a rally before putting new shorts on there. I wouldn't be looking to try and bottom pick it though. I'm quite happy to leave this sector alone. Financials do not look great. We've made a new low here, and reporting season's been mixed. I think Goldman and Morgan Stanley reports were pretty good, and I think JP Morgan was a tad disappointing. Industrials have broken down as well. I mean, this sector was looking pretty good, didn't make new highs, broken down below the 200-day moving average and below this retracement level here, 38.2, so not looking particularly strong. I don't get too excited about the 200-day moving average, by the way, folks, when it's horizontal, okay? When you've got a flat 200-day moving average line, tells you nothing about trend, so I wouldn't get too excited about that at this level. Technology is looking pretty robust. We've had a fall, and again, it's tested the 50% retracement level and the 200-day moving average, very much like the NASDAQ. It's found support here. We may get another little sell-off to test this low again, but I think still inclined to give this uptrend the benefit of the doubt. Consumer staples, really backfilling between the 38.2 and the 61.8% retracement levels. Again, we've got a pretty flat 200-day moving average here. It's not really telling us very much. More interested in price levels here. And again, if we can clear this high here, we should then target these sorts of levels, which should then target new highs. Real estate was another sector that did make new highs. It's had a pretty big sell-off, pretty much like the S&P 500. Found support again at the 61.8% retracement level, flattish looking 200-day moving average. Utilities, again, found support, hasn't made new highs, but found support at the 38.2% level in the recent sell-off. Again, another flat 200-day moving average, not telling us a great deal. Healthcare has really been one of the leading sectors this year. Very nice uptrend there. It's come back and it's filling around this 55-day moving average and also the 23.6% retracement level from the April low. Consumer discretionary. This is another sector that's been leading the way up. Also made new highs in September, October. We've had a sell-off again back down to the 200-day moving average, which is still just sloping up. And again, really doing a lot of work around this 50% to 61.8% retracement level on the Fibonacci's, which is that area that I refer to as the ambush zone. So again, if we can clear these levels, I think new highs are in store for consumer discretionary. Energy sector, again, it's been looking reasonably good. We did make a new high back in May. A lot of sideways action since then. It's held pretty firmly though at this 50% retracement level. If we break here, we could certainly target levels down around here, which was around where the original breakout came. Dow Jones actually looks fairly similar to the S&P 500, with the exception that it looks like we're already starting to trace out a bit of a W bottom here. So one to keep an eye on. If these levels hold, then I think that's really good news for the market. This is the US 30-year bond, clearly in a downtrend, clearly yields heading higher. That's definitely trending down. I wouldn't get too excited about a huge rally here at this stage. Now, I mentioned in my article last week that the fact that we haven't seen a massive flight to safety in bonds, actually means that there doesn't appear to be a great deal of panic around. There have been stories circulating in the press that apparently three hedge funds shuttered in the last week or two, and that has led to selling and reduced liquidity in the market, which may have over-exacerbated the sell-off in equities. But we haven't seen a massive bid in bonds, which sort of suggests that we're not seeing a big panic and a big flight to safety kind of bid. TLT, which is the 20-year plus Treasury bond ETF, also clearly in a downtrend. And again, we haven't seen a massive flight to safety bid there either. Gold, well, look, the gold bugs may have their day in the sun one day, but it kind of hasn't happened yet. Still hasn't even reclaimed this 38.2% retracement level from the April highs. It probably could, it probably should, but I really just don't get too excited about gold at the moment. Oil still remains in an uptrend. This will be the level to watch around this sort of 67, 67.50 level, which is the bottom of the downtrend channel and coincidentally also in line with the 200-day moving average. So this level around 67 gets breached, you could see further downside open up in oil, but for the time being, I'm inclined to give this uptrend the benefit of the doubt. We talked about the S&P 500. This is the IWM, which is the iShares Russell 2000 ETF, which is your big mid-cap barometer. This has been really weak. This has sort of pretty much given up all of its gains for the year now. But it's come back to the 61.8% level, also previous support level. Every good reason to expect that this could find support here. It is below the 200-day moving average, which is flat, but if it finds support here, it probably could reclaim that level fairly easily. I wouldn't get all bared up on this yet. And then here is just another look at the advanced decline line, which hasn't collapsed. Okay, the advanced decline line is a breadth measure. It's still clearly in an uptrend, which is good news for the bull market. And the other thing that we're seeing here is that this low here is actually higher than the previous low in August, which is what we call bullish divergence, because this low here is lower than the previous low in the stock market in August. So the advanced decline line does not argue for a breakdown in the bull market yet. I want to be clear that the trend is still a bit uncertain. I expect that the market can make new highs, and I still think we could see the market significantly higher than here by the time this bull market has run its course. We just have not seen the type of sentiment that you see, in the type of euphoria that you see at market tops. And in fact, quite the opposite. Everybody is still really quite worried. But you know, now is not the time for complacency. Don't be terrified of the market, but don't be complacent either. What I mean by that is cut your position size. Keep your position size smaller than normal until the trend reasserts itself, until the trend becomes clearer. Often what happens after a sell-off like this is people start thinking, damn it, I should be more short. I wish I had more short positions on, or I wish I had more protection in place. Now is not the time to be doing that. We've had a big sell-off. If you try and put a bunch of short positions on now, you risk really getting chopped to pieces. And don't go out buying a whole bunch of put options, because put insurance, you know, the cost of that is just skyrocketed. So what you want to be doing is just being very selective. Look for opportunities. Buy weakness, sell strength. Don't do the opposite. It's so tempting to start shorting the market after it's weakened, particularly if you don't have enough short positions on. But don't get sucked into that, folks. That is why traders lose money. It's because they're always chasing the market. They're not trying to preempt it. So if we do have a bit more of a sell-off, put some new long positions on. Just keep your position size small, though. If we do have a further rally, maybe that's the time to put on an extra short position or two. But again, keep your position size smaller than normal until this uptrend becomes clearer and reasserts itself. Anyway, that's how I'm seeing things at the moment. I hope it helps. And until next time, good trading, folks.